As I began to realize that I wanted to order my prayer life, and you have to build your whatever you're going to do around your circumstances. And all of us are different here. All of us have different circumstances. You know, some have more time than others have. Some have very busy schedules. And if you get too complicated of a prayer diary or whatever, it may be the greatest thing going, but you can't work on it. You know what I mean? You just don't have time to do it. So instead of it being a blessing, it's almost like having an anchor around your neck that just keeps convicting you because I don't have the time to work the thing. And I've learned that in my own life because of my crazy schedule is just so different. And so I don't use this every day. Simply the way that my schedule goes. But I use it on the weekends. The weekends are special times for me. Not for you, that's just me. And I get up early on the weekends too. I like to at least put 4 or 5 hours in prayer and scripture before I go to church on Sunday morning. So, I mean, that's me. And you're saying, well, to be spiritual, you got to put 4. No, that's not what I'm saying. I'm just saying that fits our schedule better. I am not a night person. I used to be a night person, and I was always a night owl, and as a pastor, you know, counseling at night, because I love to counsel, and if I can help anybody, you know, the most positive stroke in my life is not standing up here talking to you, but if I said one thing to somebody to help them, now that excites me, you know, but not just talking to groups, it's I'm individually oriented, and I'm really concerned about individuals, if I can be of any blessing. And so what I found in my life, God brought some of my heroes, their grandchildren or children, into my life. And one of my heroes was Hudson Taylor. And Hudson Taylor's grandson came to our college because a girl in our college mother had dated him. And when they were in school someplace, and so he came and I had a chance to meet him. I was thrilled. Oh, I met, you know, can I touch you? But what a thrill. But my favorite people of all, and I've shared this before, my very favorite people, and when I get to heaven, I want to see them, first of all, is Rosalind and Jonathan Goforth. And he wrote a wonderful book on revival, and I just love the Goforth. And she wrote a book that preceded revivals all over the world, How I Know God Answers Prayer, by Rosalind Goforth. That's a wonderful book. And just marvelous things that happened in her life that are just, it wasn't coincidental. You know, sometimes prayer answers can sort of be coincidental. But some of these, like one time, I found out when I was pastoring in Tacoma, Washington, that Mary Goforth, the first daughter that lived, was in the area. And she came in our church, and she showed slides of her mom and dad's work in China. Jonathan Goforth brought the last revival in China before the communists took over. And he was just like one step ahead. And many of the people in Taiwan traced their Christian heritage back to being saved under Jonathan Goforth's ministry. He was blind. And he would stand in the pulpit preaching blindly, as his wife would lead him, and thousands responded to the gospel message. They spent their whole life in China. But when Mary came and showed slides that were over 100 years old of her father's work in our church, I introduced Mary, and I said, when I read the book, and I've shared this at different places, that when they went to China as a young married couple, they were out passing tracks because they couldn't speak the language, they were learning Chinese, and they heard the fire gone, and they looked, and their house was on fire. And everything they brought to China in the 1800s was burning up. And you couldn't replace it. And Rosalind Goforth began to wring her hands. And Jonathan reached over and touched her and said, Now, Rose, it's only thanks. I mean, I thought, what if my house is on fire? But I tell them, oh, Marguerite, it's just things.
Sorry, things!
I knew I had a good book. I mean, man, this is just chapter 2 or something. I got a good book. Well, I shared that, and Mary got up and said, Mr. Logan, you forgot that my mother lost everything except the clothes on her back 5 times in her lifetime. And one of those times, she was trying to sew clothes for the kids as they were fleeing the Boxer Rebellion or whatever. And she couldn't even see anymore, and her fingers were, I think, bleeding from the needle, trying to dress all her children. And in the middle of the night, in a Chinese junk on one of the rivers, somebody hollered out, are there missionaries aboard? And they said, yes, they were afraid they're going to get them. They threw a package in, and she opened it up, and there were clothes in that package that fit every one of her children. I mean, this is just one of How I Know God Answers Prayer by Rosalind Goforth. Just wonderful, wonderful people, godly people. And so, you know, we, and I asked Rosalind, what was the key to your father? I said, your father is my greatest hero of all Christian men that have ever lived. He is my number one hero, Jonathan Goldberg. I said, what's your, you grew in the house. You remember Gottlieb says, children are God's spies. So I wanted to ask a spy, why was your dad, you know, why did God use your dad? What was about your dad? And she said, Mr. Logan, I never remember getting up in the morning in China that my dad wasn't in the Word. And I thought about our parsonage and as pastoring my second church, and I thought my kids would say, I'll never forget getting up in the morning and dad's in bed. Because I was up late at night. See, I was a night person. And I realized my kids do not know that I have a love for the Word of God. They don't see it. And so I purposed to get up in the morning, no matter how late I went to bed, so my kids would get up and see me in the Word. I wanted them in the Word. And, you know, you do it. I don't do it, but you kids, it's good for you, like castor oil. You know, it's good for you to take it. But how much better to set the example? And so I had to change my lifestyle. And I'm just saying that in your prayer life, you may have to have a different style for the week, but you may have times where you have time to be able to do the whole prayer journal that I set up. And I don't think you're going to find it real complicated, but you have it on the last page there. Because I thought, what better guide than the Lord's Prayer? And the Lord just seemed to lay that on my heart. So I want to lay it out in a way that would be something in the prayer guide. And this is my prayer guide right here. One other thing I want to say is we talked about her book having the names of God. That's only the basic names. In fact, the one thing I forgot, I called Kay Arthur. I don't know her at all. She knows about our ministry because they've encouraged people to come for counseling. But I called Kay Arthur's ministry, and I just wanted to thank her for that book and how much it meant to me. You know, often people never say anything to the authors, and they don't know whether, you know, you got a book sale, but that doesn't, you know, was it a benefit or just people just buy the thing? You know what I'm saying? And so I thought, I knew it may be encouraging her for me just to call and say, you know, I really appreciate it. And I need to tell my brother, I've read, my theological library was loaded with his books. You know, he kept me in the poorhouse. It's your fault back there, brother. My poor wife went barefoot buying his books. But, you know, books are, you want, you just don't write books to crank them out. I mean, I don't think most people do. And you want it to be a blessing. So I wanted her to know that. But the one name she left out is a basic name that I can't understand. In that book, you'll find holy is not there. Remember he said, my name is what?
Holy.
Now, there are many more names. My name notebook's about that thick where I have all the names. I think all the names of God, which are much more. But these are the basic names. I don't want you to think that this is the end of everything. There are many more names of God than that. But those are the basic names. But I wanted to have an organized, I wanted to be able to pray, start here and end here, and cover the bases. You know, how do I pray through and cover the bases? And so as I took the Lord's Prayer, and you have it here, and what I did is I broke it down by phrases, because it seems that each phrase deals with an aspect of life. And so I put it on a page. Now this page is Father. And I began to add to it things about God the Father, and then scripture verses to the side. Because I think the more that we can pray to the King, in the King's own language, the more I know I'm going to have what I pray for. If I've asked anything according to what? His will, what do I know? He heard me, and if I know he hears me, what do I know? I'm going to have the answer. So the more that my prayers can be couched in the Word of God, and the more I'm praying in harmony with the revealed truth of Scripture, the more I know that my prayers are going to be answered. And we need to see answers to prayer. We really need to see that. I know the one thing that really encouraged our kids growing up, we pastored small churches. We had terrible salaries. My first church, I made $5 less than unemployment full time. I mean, that's what they thought about the pastor. Oh, well, he doesn't do much anyway, you know. We won't pay him on the at least the unemployment amount. And so our kids saw us go through struggling times, but we prayed clothes in for them. It wasn't clothes. Or they needed shoes. We didn't have money for shoes. And we knew what it was, and we kept a prayer journal. I mean, it's just a simple prayer journal. How I know God answers prayer. Put down the request, the day it was prayed, and how God answered it. And what was thrilling to me, and another thing, if you're in ministry, we never told the kids about the struggles in the church. Churches are a mess, okay? And probably the most messed up is the pastor, and then on down. But, you know, and I was a pastor. There's all kinds of things going on in the church. How was David wounded? In the house of friends. And you're wounded by people you don't expect. And if you're not careful, and you talk about that, your kids will grow up and they want nothing to do with Christianity, they want nothing to do with full-time ministry. Still want it. I mean, why do it? Like, listen to mom and dad and all they went through. I'm not into pain, so why get into ministry? And so we were very careful not to talk about that and to write down how God answered prayer. And three of our kids are in full-time Christian ministry. And the other one and her husband are very much involved, but he's the one that makes an honest living. You know, he has a real job. But they didn't get turned off. You know what I'm saying? The kids did not get turned off. They wanted to serve God. And that's what you want. I mean, the greatest thing is for us is that all of our grandchildren are saved. And the older ones now, 20 and 18, are looking to go full-time with the Lord. So that's what you want. I mean, you get older and it's your children and your grandchildren. They really love the Lord. Do they want to walk with Him? Do they want to serve Him? That's what you want. You know, what does it profit a person to have the most marvelous prayer life and lose their family? Or in our super Bible reading schedule or whatever, no time for the family. Somehow we've got to be balanced. And but you may want a time where you pray through longer than you can at other times. Okay. So what I did is I put down the Father. It started Our Father. And see, that's what got me in my whole pilgrimage. When I put down Our Father, I'm going, I struggle with that. You know, I told you about that last night. And that's it struggled. And I knew that there was something there that wasn't right. And I had to get it right. There was something that was still not dealt with that I thought I dealt with everything. And God showed me. And I dealt with that. But I started with the Father, you know. And something like this, Father. And I wrote this down, and I don't pray it like this, but I wrote it down at the time because it was the cry of my heart. Father, I would like to spend time with You in prayer. You know I don't know how to pray or have the ability to pray in a way that would please You and significant to me. Therefore, I ask the Holy Spirit to help me pray as the Bible promises, and the Holy Spirit to keep me from being distracted as I pray. You know, I was a very rotten person, got saved through the Navigators, went into the Army 3 months after I was saved. Our family at Thanksgiving and Christmas time got together, got drunk, and told dirty stories. Isn't that what you do at Thanksgiving and Christmas? Well, yeah, I think that's what you do. That's all I ever knew. I mean, when that's what you grow up in, and that's all you know, that's what? That's all you know. I wasn't in anybody else's house for Christmas or Thanksgiving. That was my home. So my mind was filled with all these dirty stories. So I hear him in the Army, and oh, thank God, we had some hillbilly. I mean, this hillbilly was a mammoth hillbilly. He must have been John Bunyan's son. And we were in this barracks, and he's a believer. And I'll have to give you a demonstration. So he'd say, "All right, you guys, shut up. The Christians are going to pray. Kneel." And we'd all kneel by our bed. And nobody would dispute Bill, let me tell you. He'd do the same thing. He'd sit down at the table. You know, the Army's at the big tables. "All right, you guys, shut up. We're going to pray here. Dear Lord, we bless this food and the Lord." And everybody shut up while Bill's praying on the table. But we have to cover our cake because the guys would steal our cake while we're praying. So we put our hand over our cake. But well, what happened was I'd pray and I'd shut my eyes and I'd think of dirty stories. And I'm being honest with you, and I'm thinking, it's not worth praying. But then there's this key I learned in counseling, the demonized, and that is watch and pray. Much better, you know, because you could see what's happening. So I realized if I opened my eyes, you know, I wouldn't have those. I didn't know to resist the enemy. I didn't understand what was going on. All I knew is those awful things that I wanted to forget were coming to my mind when I shut my eyes to pray. And that's why I'm praying. Don't be distracted. It's amazing when you go to pray, all the things that can happen, right? Naturally and unnaturally. Phone rings, someone wants you, there's a noise, or you start thinking about something at work, you start solving a problem, you start praying, and you trip off. Anybody here trip off when they pray? Right, thank you, brother. One honest Baptist of the whole bunch. But see, then maybe we need to open our eyes, you know, because we can trip off. And I found that to discipline my mind, it's very hard. Our mind's what's under attack. Spirit says, the Bible says, it's what comes under attack of the enemy, is my mind. And Satan doesn't want me to pray. So he'll put a thought in and I go off with that thought. It doesn't have to be a bad thought. It could just be anything. You know, instead of praying about my problem, I try to resolve it in my mind. So that was the idea of praying. And one of the things there, I said, God, help me to experience You as my Abba Father. Remember, I struggled with that really bad. But I wanted that. I wanted that intimate relationship with God. I knew other people had it. And I knew I wasn't a stepchild or adopted. Well, I was adopted biblically, you know, biblical adoption. But, you know, I was in the family of God. And I wanted that sense of family. Not family. I get family from you guys. You guys give me a good feeling. But I wanted that feeling with God. I wanted to feel accepted and part of that family of His. And that was part of my prayer when I talked about, you see what I'm doing? I'm taking the Father and I'm praying about the issue of the Father and how much I needed that and how much I wanted to love Him and how much I wanted to know Him as Father. So that dealt with the Father. Then the next issue would be the issue of heaven. And heaven is my future home, isn't it? Our Father, which art where? In heaven. Well, heaven is my future home, and what a joy is. What do I know about heaven? There's going to be no more tears there. Aren't you glad? Now, it says we're going to cry there. I know our brother's written some good books on future things and all that kind of stuff. But I wonder, if Jesus is going to do the judging, and we're going to be where He is, and I thought, isn't it interesting that if that is chronological, that the tears follow the great white throne judgment? Doesn't it? Isn't it chapter 21 where it talks about no more tears, the former things wiped away and so on? Why would there be tears? And the reason I thought there'd be tears is if we're with Him, we're not going to be judged there, but if we're with the judge, if we're with Him, we're going to be where He is. And we see a neighbor that comes and is cast into hell forever. And all they have to do is look over at us in a sense like, you mean you knew this and you never said anything over the fence? You never said a word to me about this? Or a relative we felt threatened by, and we never shared, and there they are cast in the lake of fire forever and ever. It seems like tears would follow there, but the Lord is going to wipe them away. This summer, my kids took, my son took 20 young people through Europe from the church. There were 80 kids all together. They started in Dunoon, Scotland, ended down in Florence, Italy. They went 2 months witnessing and sharing Christ all across Europe. There was 80 teenagers all together in this group that went. And at the end of the trip, they gave the kids three things to take back to the different churches they were from. One was, it's Royal Servants is the name of the organization that he went with. They gave the kids a little towel because as a picture of being servants, a reminder to be a servant. They gave the kids a gold key, which was the key to their purity because they made a commitment to stay pure to marriage as a reminder of that commitment. But the last thing they gave them was the most interesting thing. They gave them a tiny little vial with a cork on it to put their tears in that they'll shed for the lost. How interesting. Let's have that bring it to how God says in Revelation He's going to save our tears. And so, no more tears. There's not going to be any more death. There's going to be no more sorrow, no more pain, no more sin. You know, and I put that down and I thank God that that's my future. You know, as we're getting into prayer, God's throne is there. Worship is directed that way. Glory is directed that way. I mean, I put Revelation things. Honor, thanks, power, and grace to help is all there. We can come to that throne of grace. And I'm approaching that throne of grace in heaven because of the shed blood of Christ and so on. I thank Him for that. But now, we get in Hallowed be thy name. And that's where I got into the names of God. And that's where I put my names of God. And much more than, and I have a whole huge book. Now, what I do in my praying here, as I'm approaching this, is I take one name for God and the aspects of that name and pray it through. I don't go through the whole list. You mean all of the names? Because you can add. This is the beginning. A little bit you have. But you go through her book, and you may like to go through some of the others that Elmer, is it Elmer Towns that works for Jerry Falwell? Wrote a wonderful book on the names of God. It's the two most practical ones. It's hers and Elmer Towns' book on the names of God. And you get a lot of insights where he gives all the names for God in the 23rd Psalm. It's really interesting how each aspect of the 23rd Psalm appeals to one of the names of God. He picks the names of God in each phrase in the 23rd Psalm. So a lot of people have done some real work, and you see this. But God's name, and I take that one name. One of the names I like, and one of the names that gives a lot of comfort to me, and don't ask me why. I tried to think about it. I don't know why. It's Jehovah. And one of the aspects of the name of Jehovah is this. I will be who I will be. That comforts me. In prayer. God will be who you'll be regardless of me. Thank God for that. You know what I'm saying? Somehow, I don't know. I mean, just for me, that it's comforting to know he'll be who he'll be. We're biography nuts, and we probably have now 1,200 biographies, Christian biographies, in our basement that we've collected over the years. And still one of my favorite, very favorite one, I share this wherever I go, is John Payton, 30 Years with the Cannibals. And one of the things in that book that so spoke to my heart is when John Payton was out weeding the garden, and a cannibal was standing over with a musket going to kill him. And he kept weeding the garden, and this cannibal kept moving along with the musket. I don't know if a guy had a gun on me, if I would keep weeding the garden. And so later on, someone asked him, in a sense, how could you do that? He said, well, God is in control. If it's my time to die, he'll kill me. If not, I got to get this garden weeded. And I love that. I will be who I will be. Can't we rest in that? I thank God that I have a God who's Jehovah. You know, and he's in control. And this, of course, there's another name for that. But and I go through and I write some of those things down and what it means to me, and I thank God for who he is and claim that name. And usually that name affects the rest of my prayer. You know, it kind of that aspect of God's character affects the rest of my prayer. Then the next time I pray, I have one of those little sticker arrows, you know, that they give you for lawyers use them. These things. You see it? You know what I'm saying? So I just move it down. I have a plastic page. So the next time I pray is the God Most High, Adonai. And then when I pray through that one, I move it down. So that I pray through all the aspects of God's character, not in one time, but in that one prayer, I use just, you see what I'm saying? I focus on God that one time. Whether it's only on Saturday and Sunday, if I can do some of this during the week, it's fine. But I'm not in bondage to this. I mean, God, you know, oh, I got to pray, oh, brother. you know, that's not what God wants. But I want to cover the bases sometimes. I just don't want to just have spontaneous prayer and not cover the issues. And so we need to cover the issues at times. So that's where you can put God's name is right here. Hallowed be thy name. And I know that I'm to live in a way to what? To hallow God's name. I'm his child. You know, I like the 23rd Psalm. In fact, I have a copy of that here, and we're going to have to go just about when I get through speaking. But I wrote down, this is the 23rd Psalm with that name, and I can leave it out if someone wants to look at it when we get through, if you're interested in seeing how he took the different aspects of God's character. But one of the things, you know, often in our day we need guidance. Do you ever need guidance? You're not sure what to do? You know, it's easy to discern between evil and good, but it's hard sometimes, like Paul said to the Philippians, that you would be able to discern God's best. Because, see, good can rob me from the best. Isn't that right? And often, in a growing Christian, one who's walking with God, Satan will throw good things in our path so we miss the best. We need discernment, and we need to pray for that. And one of the aspects of God's character that means so much to me is the 23rd Psalm. It said, he will lead me in paths of righteousness, what? For his name's sake. You know what he's saying? And I went to the scriptures, and I wrote along this 23rd Psalm every time that was claimed from Genesis to Revelation. And that is, God will lead me in the right path, for his reputation's at stake. It's not my reputation. It's his reputation. God, I don't know what to do here. Often we have counselees. I don't know what to do. You know, I don't have all the answers. But I know who does, you know, and I'm glad that God puts me in situations where I have to cry out to him. God, I don't know what to do, but this is not my child, it's yours, and they're hurting, and they're here, they're not here by accident. You know, you brought them here, and we want to help them. And what's the answer? Show us what's the answer. Give us a breakthrough, you know. We want to be there for them, but we don't know what to do. And I'm glad we don't know what to do. You know, we're not sheep, and our office shouldn't run people through the sheep dip. You know, next, let's see, it's 20 after, we're supposed to be through this. You know what I mean? You just feel like you're being shoved through something, and you get through, and the fleas are gone, but you know, the wool's still dirty or whatever. You know, it's just somehow it wasn't a person. And so there needs to be that person thing going on there. But I know I need to cry out for God's reputation. That's his reputation, and I've done it all through Scripture. Remember when God told Moses, I am so, this is a Logan, this is King Logan. You know, it's not King James. He said, I am so sick of the children of Israel. I've had it up to here. I'm going to destroy them all, and I'm going to start all over again with your descendants. And Moses said, the tribe of Moses. Sounds good. You know, I mean, what a temptation. And what did Moses say? God, what will the heathen think of you if you destroy these people? Who was he concerned about? Moses' reputation or whose reputation? He plead God's reputation. You'd be amazed in Scripture. I wrote down the columns of my Bible, verses after verses after verses, where men and women of Scripture cried out for God's reputation in prayer. They pleaded the reputation of God. And God is able to lead me, and I can trust him in that. Because it's his reputation is important, not mine. And I have some other things. You may find other little bits and things in here. I have a list of the names of Jesus for 31 days, and I use that day. I have Neil Anderson's stuff. Neil is a good friend of mine, and we did this thing, Who Am I? Getting my identification for who I am in Christ. And so in those, I take a portion of that a day. You know, I am the salt of the earth. I'm the light of the world or whatever. Go through that and pray that back to God and thank who I am. Then we have another one, if you've been to our office, that I really like, By God's Grace, What I Am, because of God's grace in my life, and that's broken down in 7 days. We do that. So that's kind of all in the beginning here. And then as we move through the 23rd Psalm, His kingdom come. Now, I'm not going to get into theological whatever. When I went to Bible school, they taught me something, and I croaked over it ever since. They said that the Gospels were not relevant. That relevance started in Acts. And so all the things in the Gospel are about the millennial kingdom, and you just X them out. And yet, when I read, is it Timothy, where he said we base sound teachings on the words of Christ, and that would lead to Christ-like living. So for much of my early Christian life, I wouldn't even bother to teach the Gospels to our people. You know, isn't it amazing? In many Bible colleges and seminaries, the life of Christ is, you know what it is? An elective. Do you think you could go to a school of and study to be a Muslim and take the life of Muhammad as an elective? Something doesn't smell right. Does it sound right to you? To go clear? I mean, there are guys that go clear through Bible colleges and seminaries and never studied the life of Christ. You know, chronologically or whatever. Sad. And the words of Christ. And is that really true? Do we really base sound Christ, you know, words on Christ's words? And that what leads to godliness. And so I realized I was missing something. So I'm not going to get into, you know, the theological part of this. But God's kingdom, I want it to come in my life in that sense. I want God's blessing in my life.
This is the end of side one. Please turn your cassette over now to continue with side two.
I want God's blessing in my life. I want the blessing of God in my life. I want intimacy with God. And I pray here about my life to be pleasing to Him. And I run through some of the fruit of the Spirit. I mean, I'm not saying you have to do this. I'm saying this is how I do it. And I ask God to reveal what are things in my life that I need to be, you know, I need to be working on. Are there areas He wants to put His finger on in my life? You know, have I been loving? Where is the most difficult place to be loving for most of us? At home. Yeah. Where is it? One of the most difficult places for us to, I can't even think of the fruit of the Spirit. Gentle, you know, gentleness and meekness. It's not at work. It's at our house. You know, the people in my house need to see the fruit of the Spirit more than the people at work. Don't they? And yet that seems to be the hardest place to live Christianity is in my home. Because we just kind of let it all hang out there. And we need to pray. You know, my availability, am I open to God's leading? Do I really have a servant's heart? Have I really demonstrated a servant's heart to my wife, to my children, at work? You know, these are things. God, I want it to come into my life. I want to be, this is where I pray about being a man of prayer. Lord, reveal my prayerlessness, you know. Lord, I want to be guided by your Spirit as I pray. Am I really sensitive to the Spirit of God as I pray? And can He lead me in praying and so on? Take moral inventory in my life. Am I really growing? Is there things that God wants me to do? One of the videos we show is awesome, and you're going to hear her. Nancy DeMoss is one of the most awesome speakers that I know. And we show a video on Wednesday to all of our counselees, Nancy DeMoss's video on brokenness. It's the most wonderful video I've ever seen on what it means to be a broken person before the Lord. What is really brokenness? And we show that often. The guys will be crying, sobbing with their head on the table. And I've talked to Nancy about it, what a blessing that video has been as people have sobbed before the Lord watching that video because of the sin in their life and how they've sinned against God and they're broken. And brokenness is it's just marvelous. She talks about how God used broken things. If you've never seen that video, it is just one of the best I've ever seen. Nancy gave it in Colorado to 4,000 Campus Crusade leaders. Now, Nancy didn't tell me the results, but I found out from Campus Crusade people. This is all their leadership style. She spoke on brokenness, and when she got through speaking, they canceled the rest of the meetings as people got their hearts right with God. And as she said there, is, you know, sometimes I pray when I ask God, is there something I need to do? And Nancy says it so well. She said, often I don't need to ask God what I need to do. I already know. But it's what I don't want to do. It's the thing I least want to do. And that's exactly what God wants me to do. It's a wonderful video. And most all of our counselees buy it and take it with them. They said, this thing just, it was like the thing that was the last straw. It brought them to the end of self. Was her video. As we started through their life and they begin to see how the enemy worked, then they realize they have not really been broken over their sin. Often we're broken over the consequences. You know, my wife is going to leave me, the kids are all upset and all that, but if not, that, you know, I have to see it, I'm sinning against God. But this is the part where it becomes more personal in my prayer diary right here, that I cry out to God for myself and that area. Okay, the next area. And I have in here, I put my family here. I pray for my wife. I pray about her. I pray for my children. I pray for my grandchildren. They're all under this part of the ministry. The presence of God would be there and pray specifically for them. And sometimes I know what my grandkids are going through. I know that the reason our grandkids are as decent as they are is one of the real major reasons is that my wife is an intercessor. She should have been the one preaching it. You know, but my wife would never get up here and do it. I mean, that's just not her. But she has been a woman of prayer my whole life. You know, and she just was so... In fact, I'd be intimidated to pray with her because my wife is so godly. She's always been godly. It's just hard. I mean, most of you have never met my wife. But my wife committed her life to Christ at 3 years of age and went and grew up in a home situation worse than mine. And when she wanted to backslide in sin as a teenager, she put on some fingernail polish and some lipstick and went to 3 movies. And showed up at church, painted up. Now, I'm not knocking paint. She paints today. But she was in the Salvation Army, and they didn't do that. And that was, you know, and that's my evil wife. I mean, our kids got a godly, godly man. And a woman that grew up, you know, incestuous, alcoholic, whatever. And God put his protection around her. And no one ever touched her purity or her violated her physically. What was going on all over the place. Or even in the neighborhoods where they lived and so on. God protected her because God has something special for her. And I got a crowning jewel and I need to pray for her. And intercede for her. But this is where I intercede for her and my family and my grandchildren and so on. And I am thankful. A lot of people are not committed to courtship. They think it's too strict and too whatever. But there's some guy out, Josh somebody or other, kiss dating goodbye. And my granddaughters are going to hear him. And they were driving 4 hours one way to go hear him. And I was thanking God they were. And Life Action gave me the book. And I thought, well, I'm not in the mood for dating. it's kind of past. In fact, Oliver Price, do you remember having me come here and speak about 100 years ago? And I came to his church, and I gave a seminar on how to date on a spiritual level. We were teaching our kids in the college, and I did a dating seminar in his church years and years ago. He was good-looking, and so was I. It was a long time ago. Both had head of hair and all. and did one there, and the Lord really blessed us. We were going around teaching how to date on a different level. And not physical dating, but spiritual dating with all men and getting kids to do things on that level. Well, this book is like that. And so my wife read it. She says, you ought to read it. And I read it, and it's wonderful. So if courtship seems too difficult or too far, look at this. You know, and maybe a kid could read this. Or you know kids that could benefit from this and No physical dating in high school. It's amazing. This is written by 20. My granddaughter says, he's only 22. You know, can you imagine? He's only 22. I was doing a dating seminar in a large Christian high school in Kansas City, and I was talking about this thing, and this guy turned to a girl and said, what does that old man know about dating anyway? And the girl said, he's my father. And I'd see the kid, I said, I'm her old man. Oh, Mr. Logan, I'm so sorry. But let me tell you, the families are going down the tube. Somebody better do something. And fathers better start interceding for their kids and their grandchildren. Someone's got to start praying for them. You know, pray for them now before they're pregnant and have abortions and end up in prison. You know, start way before all of that. Pray God's protection on these children. You know, any child that loves the Lord becomes a target for the enemy. The enemy wants them sidetracked. He wants them to scar their life so bad. And you can't imagine the young kids that come into my office that are so scarred. I mean, it's unbelievable that a 13-year-old boy or a 13-year-old girl could be so evil. Have done so many wicked, evil things in Christian families. I don't see non-Christians. Missionaries' kids and so on. Pastors' kids. And all this stuff's unbelievable. The evil that's out there and all the, you know, the temptations for these kids. Somebody better stand in the gap and make up the hedge for these kids and pray God's hedge of protection around them and so on. But that's the section there where we do that. And I also include our nation. This is where I pray for our leaders, our national leaders, and so on. There's a lot of guides out there you can stick in your notebook to pray for your leaders, but there's so many of them, you're going to have to break them down with an arrow. You know what I'm saying? You're saying, boy, you'll be praying forever. I know that. So I'm saying if you just pray for a few and move the arrow down, you know, at least you get through the list. You know, it's so easy to run down Clinton, isn't it? For most of us. But is that what God says? Run the president down, and you'll live in peace. You know, he says, run him up. Isn't that what he says? Run him up. That we might live what? A quiet and a peaceable life. And most of us would rather run down our leaders than ever run them up. And so we need to know who they are and begin to run them up before the throne of God. We need to pray for those in authority that are over us. And pray that God would be working in their lives and so on. And you'll find Dobson will put things out, or different groups put things out, you know, with lists of who the leaders are, or how to pray, and so on. I got this this little thing in the mail. Just, you know, I stick it in there. 30 ways to pray for people and influence. Let's just talk about leadership. 30 ways. I don't know where it came. It came in the mail. I just said, this is good. And why reinvent the wheel? So I just slipped it in my little thing and stuck it in there and work through this. You know, I don't want you to be overwhelmed, but it's a way of working through. Do I need to pray for my family? Do I need to honor the Lord? Do I need to exalt him in my prayer? Yes. Do I need to pray for myself? Yes. Do I need to pray for my wife? Yes. Do I need to pray for our grandkids? Yes. Do I need to pray for those in authority? Yes. They need to be in there somewhere. And this is where I stuck it in that whole area. Pray for the church. I pray for where I work. That's all in this intercessory part here, praying that God would manifest himself in a very special way. Then this give us this day, that section is what? Provisions. You know, what we need, our daily needs, and so on. And I feel sorry for families that don't need anything. See, because it's often our needs that do what? Drives us to prayer. And it's often our needs to see God answer our prayer in what? Tangible ways. You know, we want to see something tangible. Well, we can see it tangibly as in praying for needs and seeing God meet our needs. And keep a record of that, and especially with your kids. This is too complicated for kids. But to pray with your kids and make a list of needs and let them see that God can meet their needs. That they can trust him. That God, and I tell my counselees, is God worthy of your trust? Now, can you trust him? And some have a hard time trusting him. But he's worthy of your trust. You can trust him. So list your needs. What kind of needs do you have? All kinds. Fellowship, financial, guidance, you know, on and on. All those kinds of needs can list there. And I have scripture verses where connected with those needs, that God can meet those needs. And then the next one, developing spiritual protection. Deliver us. You know? Lead us not into temptation. Deliver us from the evil one. And the scriptures there, the spiritual head, God setting the fortress around us, God's present power, the armies of heaven, yeah, when I saw the Lord of hosts is with us. What a tremendous name. The Lord of hosts. It's the commander chief who rules the armies of heaven that can never lose is what? With us. Why were the shepherds afraid? How many times have you ever seen innumerable warring angels? There weren't little babies up there, you know, with banners and perfume. It was all the armies of heaven as far as you could see. And they said, what? Be not afraid. Tim Warner, that teaches taught at Trinity, was working with a 9-year-old girl, and an angel appeared at her bed. And this angel said he had a message from God for her. And this little girl didn't think it was. She said, I don't think you're from God. And the angel said, yes, I am. All dressed up, you know, all glowing and, you know, angelish. And said, yes, I am. I said, well, I don't think you are. He said, why? Because she said, you didn't say, be not afraid. And he said, you want to see me like this? And it was a demon appearing as an angel of light. And she resisted him. Now, Tim Warner is a credible man. He was over all the doctorate degrees for Trinity. You know, when he was teaching there, now he's retired, travels with Neil Anderson. Often we have kids that see things. See angels or demons and all this kind of stuff. It sounds unusual to you guys, but just come and answer our phone. Just stay in our office 1 week and answer the telephone. Take about 100 of these calls of families of what the enemy activity is being stepped up in America and what these kids are going through and what they see. And they need someone praying for them. They need parents putting a protection over them and over their family and so on, and praying about being delivered from the enemy. Okay. Experiencing forgive us. You know, are there things in my life I need to forgive? That's got to be a daily thing. You will be hurt if you're a Christian. You know, I can't drop some kind of a tube over you and you're not going to be hurt, or you're not going to be tempted by the enemy. That's a part of life that's going to happen. And when I get hurt, what do I do with it? Do I let the sun go down on my stuff? And then the final issue, yours is the kingdom and the power. You know, Lord, let me live away in your kingdom and in your power that would glorify you. Lord, strengthen me with the power in the inner man. And Lord, glorify yourself to me today in my life. That's how I end the thing. So to me, that was a way of praying. And one of the books that I got that was probably the most practical, helpful book, and I saw it because this is what I wanted, Becoming a Man of Prayer. And as I set up my prayer thing, all of a sudden, this guy's done the same thing. I didn't know who he was. I don't know who was it? Bob Belt? I don't know who the guy is. Somewhere he's in Colorado or something, and I think he's with the Promise Keepers or I don't know what. It's a NAV Press book, so they can't go wrong. It's NAV Press. And I want to be a man of prayer. May I get some help here? And I got it. And he had laid out his prayer journal the same way. And so there's a lot of help here. And in fact, in the back, he shows one, you know, how to set up a prayer journal with scripture verses under the Lord's Prayer. So I would encourage you. I've given you the idea. If you like that idea, you may want to get this book that he's written that will help you to use the Lord's Prayer as it's broken down phrase by phrase as a guide for your own personal prayer life. And becoming a man of prayer. Now, if you buy, ladies, you can pretend you're buying it for your husband. But I think you'd be a woman of prayer, too. It's just a genetic thing here. Because men are buying books right now, so everything's geared towards men. Well, let's pray. Father, we do thank you. We thank you that you have taught us how to pray. And we pray that, Lord, we need to order our life and our prayer life. And we need to start somewhere and end somewhere. And we need to include stuff in between. And I just pray that if the Lord's Prayer would be the key here, that people might be able to take it, break it down, and start a little prayer journal and begin to pray through the issues of life and see you in a new way, meeting needs and doing things that would be exceedingly abundantly above all they could ask or believe because of your power that's working through us and your desire that we would fellowship with you and walk with you. We ask this that you would be glorified in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.